and I started working on lactoferrin. And since 30 years, I've been working on this. Of course, I have several other projects in the lab, but this is the project that I love the most. So I thought that I will speak on this. Just a minute. Okay, so this is what our lab, that is the protein structural biologist. Okay, so the structure of a drug target is used to discover and design leads and microbial drug therapeutics. Why I wanted to work on antimicrobial
lost?
Yeah, I think like there is some connection issue at Sujata ma'am's end actually. I think her connection is lost because the screen has freeze. I think like there's some technical issue. I think because she has also left the meet. We'll wait, ma'am.
I think there was a problem with the internet connection, maybe.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, after first slide, like I think your connection was lost. So maybe you can start from the first slide itself.
Okay, I'll start again. Could you please tell me at what point did you lose me? Shall I start right from the beginning?
The moment you like change the slide, the the connection got lost, ma'am. So maybe second slide.
Okay, so
second slide. Yeah.
This was the second slide. So I was just telling you that my lab is working on rational structure-based lead design, where we use three-dimensional structures of a drug target to discover and design leads. This is antimicrobial drug therapeutics. And this is a slide to show you how drugs used to be discovered in the past, where trial and error approach on naturally derived substances was used. So it was completely based on chance. It was based on serendipity, and absolutely there was no rationale, no logic as to how to discover drugs. I'm a long way from those days, and the three scientists who transformed drug design were these. All of them were Nobel laureates. The first was Roentgen, who discovered X-rays, and he got Nobel Prize in Physics in 1901. Second was Max Lavey, who got Nobel Prize in Physics in 1914. And he's the one who actually correlated protein crystals to the structure. And third was Alexander Fleming, who got Nobel Prize in Physiology and Medicine in 1945. And he was the one, as you all know, who discovered the first antibiotic, which we now know as penicillin. So let me just tell you about what he spoke. This penicillin was discovered by chance once again. He said that one sometimes finds what one is not looking for. When I woke up just after dawn on September 28, 1928, I certainly did not plan to revolutionize all medicine by discovering the world's first antibiotic or bacteria killer, but I guess that is exactly what I did. So I just want to tell you that before Alexander Fleming actually discovered penicillin, we were living in the pre-antibiotic era, where even one a small minor bacterial infection used to mean the end of life. And then after he discovered penicillin, there was a huge revolution. So many antibiotics were discovered and they were brought into the mainstream medicine. But sadly, what happened was that there was an antibiotic overuse, or rather should I say misuse, where medical practitioners were simply prescribing antibiotics even when it was not required. And also people were taking antibiotics on their own, because of which bacteria, being extremely smart, actually found ways to resist antibiotics. And what happened was, and what we are facing right now, is antibiotic resistance. And what is the fear? The fear is that we are slowly going into a post-antibiotic apocalypse, which would mean we are going right back to the pre-antibiotic era. So we are literally sitting on a ticking time bomb. And what my fear and what my concern is that the COVID era has only hastened this antibiotic resistance, because of the lockdowns, people are unable to access their doctors. So they are self-prescribing. Also because of COVID, because of several people actually catching COVID, there are several secondary bacterial infections. And so antibiotics are being used left, right, and center. There is absolutely no regulation, and probably antibiotic resistance era is going to come sooner than we thought. So the basic question is that why do we need to discover new drugs, especially in case of antimicrobial therapeutics, is because, of course, as I mentioned, antibiotic resistance. Secondly, new diseases, as you are aware, that we suddenly got hit by a new virus. And of course, to improve efficiency and reduce duration. As you know, if I give you an example of tuberculosis, it's been 50 years since we actually got a new drug for a very mainstream disease like tuberculosis. The drug discovery process is extremely slow. It takes a lot of money, and that is why a lot of people wonder if this is worth it. But yes, it is worth it, definitely worth it. Drug discovery now is protein structure-based drug design, in which we study the map of the protein implicated in the disease, which leads to ultimately the drug design. So if I have to compare towards your left, you will see a man walking through a forest, and then towards your right, you will see a Google map on your phone, on a smartphone. So that is the difference between the past, drug discovery in the past, and drug discovery now. Because now we have structural information of protein ligand interactions that we can use to develop new compounds with increased potency and selectivity. And of course, over here, I have given the lock and key model. This is light blue is the protein, and this is the active site. And this dark blue is the substrate. So what we do is we check what kind of active site there is, what is the stereochemistry of the active site, what is the shape and the various intricacies of the active site, and what kind of substrate binds to it. And then we make a drug, or we actually design a molecule, whether it is peptide or whether it is a organic compound, which also fits exactly like the substrate. And so the substrate is not able to bind to the active site. Hence, that leads to the end of the disease. Now, this is one of the molecules that we have done in our lab, that is phospholipase A2, which is upregulated in rheumatoid arthritis. As you can see, this red is the molecule, and this green area is the active site, the substrate recognition site. The blue residues are the active sites. And looking at this, we have designed various molecules. I will not go into that because that is not the topic of today. And this is just to show you another molecule in which the active site is W-shaped. This is the active site. So this is just a schematic representation to tell you that this is how the substrate binds. And this is the peptide that we have designed over here, which also binds to the active site. So what happens when you actually design the peptide and synthesize and make it bind? Your substrate is unable to bind. And that is how we regulate the disease. So the idea. The disease. So the ideal drug is which has high affinity, low molecular weight, so that it's easy, long life, it should not decay right in your body, should be easy to administer either orally or intravenously, and of course, low toxicity. The cure should not be worse than the disease. The ideal drug target should be essential, so that when I say essential, I mean that it should be so necessary for the life cycle of the bacteria is that if it is eliminated, then the bacteria should also die.
I think she has again lost the connection. I'll just call her back. Sujata ma'am, your voice is not audible, ma'am.
Okay, can you hear my voice now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am, now it is audible.
Audible.
But your presentation is not visible now. actually there is some technical issue at her end, so she is joining from another device. So hopefully then there should not be any problem. So we can wait for 2-3 minutes.
Okay, are you able to hear me now?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible and now you can share your
You
screen.
can, actually when I'm trying to start my video, just a minute. Okay, got it. So I'll go back to my slide presentation. I hope this time the internet connection will stay. So could you please tell me at what point did you lose me?
Ma'am, like where you are showing competitive inhibition by the like the design peptide, yeah.
Right, so I've done that. And this is just to, talk about this also, the ideal drug?
Like this is where you lost the connection, ma'am. So maybe
okay.
You can, yeah.
So basically these are some of the properties of ideal drug. It's got high affinity. It should have high affinity. It should have low molecular weight so that it is easy to synthesize. Long serum half-life so that it should not decay rapidly. And it should be easy to administer either orally or intravenously. And finally, it should have low toxicity so that the cure should not be worse than the disease. And this is the property of ideal drug target, which means it should first be essential to the bacteria so that if it is eliminated, then the entire bacteria should be able to die. Secondly, it should have a very well-defined binding pocket so that we are able to design peptides or design organic compounds for it. It should be unique. Its pathway should be unique so that no other pathway should be able to replicate the function that it is doing. And finally, inhibition, it should be able to be inhibited by using a very small molecule because we don't want a bulky or a large compound which we cannot design as a drug. So these are some of the proteins that we have been working on in our lab. There are something like 24 to 25 classes of proteins that we have crystallized in our lab. And our lab is number one in the world in the number of protein structures that we have deposited in the protein data bank. And finally, coming to the area that I'm going to be talking about is antimicrobial drug therapeutics. We have a dual-pronged strategy in our lab. We do two kinds of work. First is that we either develop ligands against bacterial protein targets, and the bacteria that we are mostly working on are the ones which are multi-drug resistant bacteria like Acinetobacter baumannii. Secondly, we work on natural antimicrobial proteins, which can be used as the future antibiotics. Now, why do we work on innate immunity proteins? That is the natural immunity proteins. Because over millions of years, they have retained their effectiveness and there are no emergence of resistant strains. And they can bind to multiple components of bacterial envelope. Also, they have multiple functions, like they are also able to do the immunomodulation. And they simultaneously induce a lot of responses in the bacteria through independent pathway. And finally, the antibacterial effects of these proteins are enhanced by other innate immune response. So this is what is happening nowadays. People are falling back on the innate immunity proteins because we have realized that these innate immunity proteins are the ones which have actually learned to be as smart as the bacteria that they are dealing with. And these are the three innate immunity proteins that we have been working on since the past 20, 30 years. First is, of course, lactoferrin, which I'm going to be talking about. Second is lactoperoxidase. And third is peptidoglycan recognition protein. So let's talk about lactoferrin. Lactoferrin is basically maximally found in the milk, or rather the colostrum, that is the first milk of the mother. And its main function is that it is a complete armor for the neonate. And it is multifunctional, so it is responsible for the defense, nutrition, and development of the newborn. And it is an iron-binding glycoprotein, and it was first discovered, as I said, in colostrum. Though it is majorly present in colostrum, but it is also found in other exocrine secretions, synovial fluids, sweat, pancreatic fluids, amniotic fluids, genital fluids, and also it is found in neutrophils. So let's talk about though it has got many functions, let's talk about its antimicrobial function, which is very, very potent. It sequesters iron. That means it takes away the iron from the iron requiring bacteria, viruses, fungi, and it depletes, you know, iron is very much required for the life cycle. So it depletes these iron requiring bacteria and fungi and viruses. And that is how it is able to kill these microbes. Secondly, it inhibits by binding their biofilm formation, because, you know, many of these resistant, multi-drug resistant bacteria have this property that they are able to make biofilms. So lactoferrin is able to inhibit the formation of biofilms. Third is that it binds to lipopolysaccharides, which are present on the cell membrane of these microbes. And finally, it contains, it's an 80 kilodalton proteins within itself. It has peptides which can bind to these bacterial, fungal, and even viral proteases. And binding to them, it stops the spread of these particular microbes. So these are the other functions which have been discovered of lactoferrin. Though of course it is antibacterial, it is also shown to be anti-cancer, immunomodulation, anti-inflammatory, reduces gastropathy, wound healing, etc. So I'm going to be majorly talking about antibacterial and gastropathy reduction. Why I call it a moonlighting protein is because moonlighting means that a protein is able to perform many functions, not just one primary function, but other functions also. So these are the amounts of lactoferrin which are found in various species. In human, it's maximum. It's more than 2 milligram per ml, that is in the milk or the colostrum. And then secondly, in equine, bovine, buffalo, goat, and pig, it's a little less. And finally, in rabbit and dog, it's the least. So what we have been working on is human and bovine lactoferrin. So we have actually solved the structures of equine, buffalo, goat, pig, all of them. But for therapeutic purposes, we've been working on human and bovine because these are simply the most potent lactoferrins found. And this is the three-dimensional structure of lactoferrin that we have determined in the lab. I'll just tell you very simply that it is a bilobal protein. So it has got two lobes, N lobe, N for N-terminus. So N lobe, C lobe. Each lobe is further subdivided into two domains. So you've got N1, N2 domains of the N lobe and C1, C2 domains of the C lobe. And each lobe has got an iron binding site. As you can see, this red sphere is the iron, which it binds very strongly there. And this is how it actually sequesters the iron. And there's an interconnecting helix, as you can see, this orange one, which connects both the lobes. And this is just an animation to show you that the iron binding and release, it induces a large conformational change in which the protein adopts either open or closed. When it is in its apo form, apo means iron-free form, it is open, but then there's a large hinge movement when iron is bound, because of which it gets closed. So these are the functions that are attributed to two different lobes. N lobe is attributed to the antibacterial binding to LP lipopolysaccharides. C lobe is the one which is very interesting because it has got antibacterial, antifungal, antiviral, wound healing, reduction of gastropathy. So naturally, I got very interested in the C lobe of lactoferrin. And I actually based my entire MSc, PhD, post-PhD, even as a faculty member, as a professor, I've been working on the C lobe of lactoferrin. So here we go. This is the sequence comparison of C lobe and N lobe. And when we do the sequence comparison, we realize it's almost like 40% homology, but there are three segments in C lobe which are missing in N lobe. These are the three segments. And there's only one segment in N lobe which is missing in C lobe. So definitely C lobe has got more functions, and sequentially also it is seeming to be more interesting. So let's talk about C lobe. Now this is the neonate, and actually this is the photograph of my daughter who's when she was born. Now of course she's 22 years old, so it's an old photo, but I always use it for my slides for lactoferrin. So the question that arises is, what happens to lactoferrin when it is ingested by the neonate? Because, you know, it is natural when lactoferrin is ingested, then it will definitely get attacked by the proteases in the gut. That means in your stomach, you have pepsin, in the in the intestine, you have trypsin, chymotrypsin, and if lactoferrin goes to the various pathological sites, and there would be some proteases which could be fungal, which could be viral, and those proteases would also cut down lactoferrin, which is their nature. So the question is, how does this particular lactoferrin survive? Does the hydrolysis by proteases give equal N or C rho? So this was the question in front of us. So this is, again, just to show, this is N lobe, this is C lobe, this is the iron bound, and this is the interconnecting helix. So we wanted to cut the interconnecting helix using a protease so that we are able to generate N lobe and C lobe, which are equal monoferric, functional. So we used two types of proteases. One was a trypsin-like and the other was sertralizin-like. Trypsin-like, we used trypsin, chymotrypsin, etc. Sertralizin-like, we use proteinase K and sertralizin. I haven't put all the gels, but this is just to show what happens. When we use trypsin-like proteases, we get lactoferrin, and we get 45 kilodalton, which is a fragment of lactoferrin. We get a 38 kilodalton, and we get 21 kilodalton. This happens all the time. So, and finally, we get some peptides. But when we do sertralizin-like, we get no lactoferrin, no 45, we get only 38, no 21 LF and peptides. So sertralizin-like proteases generate only 38 LF, that is 38 kilodalton and peptides. After that, we wanted to know what exactly are the, I mean, which parts of lactoferrin are all these fragments. So we use the hydrolysate and we put it through an ion exchange chromatography in both the cases, trypsin-like and proteinase K. What we were able to generate was, and we were able to purify all these fragments, as you can see over here. So what we found was that in case of proteinase K, we are getting equal N and C lobes. But in case of trypsin, we are only getting C lobe, which is 38K. We are not getting N lobe. So C lobe is retained in both trypsin and proteinase K. C lobe is basically the lobe which is most important. This is just to show you. Native lactoferrin proteinase K makes it N lobe, C lobe, which I just described. And trypsin makes an N2 domain, which is 21 LF, C lobe, which is 38 LF, and C lobe plus interconnecting helix plus a part of N1, which makes it 45 kilodalton. So what we did was that we crystallized this C lobe, which we have generated through proteinase K hydrolysis and through trypsin hydrolysis, and of course, EPO, that means we took out the iron in case of trypsin and then we crystallized that as well. These are the various crystallization conditions of all the three C lobes. And in these two cases, they were red in color. Let me just tell you that lactoferrin is always red in color because it is iron binding. And both the lobes are also red in color. But when we take out iron, then both lactoferrin and the lobes become white in color, colorless in fact. So these are the crystals which are a bit white. And these are the three-dimensional structures of the C lobe generated by proteinase K. So I'm going to henceforth call it PK C lobe. Then trypsin FE C lobe means the C lobe generated by trypsin, which has got iron. And trypsin EPO C lobe, that means C lobe generated by trypsin from which iron was removed. And what you can clearly see over here is the difference between... Okay. So if you see the difference now, then you will see that in case of FEC lobe, as I had described earlier, it's a closed conformation. So the distance between these two residues is much lesser. It is 18.75 angstrom. And in case of EPO-C lobe, it is almost more than double. So that just shows that iron was lost and it became an open conformation. Now the question is, we wanted to check, how does trypsin cut and how does proteinase K cut? So what we analyzed was that because you know trypsin always cuts the arginine and lysine residues of the proteins, but proteinase K is a very non-specific protease. It is able to cut non-specifically. In fact, it is why it is named proteinase K is because it is even able to cut a very, very strong protein like keratin. So we realized that in the C terminus of our C lobe, there is no arginine or lysine. And hence, trypsin has not cut this portion at all. It has only cut this particular arginine 341. And in case of protease K, they were, since there are three residues over here which were completely exposed, mostly protease K and cetylizin will cut anything that's exposed. So it is able to make three cuts over here and one cut at arginine 341. So this shows how protease K is cutting. These are the exposed areas. So it has made basically four cuts over here. And finally, we've got C-lobe over here, which starts at tyrosine 342. And since there was a disulfide bond, so there is this particular fragment, which, as you can see, a red particular loop over here, which is bound by a disulfide bond to the C-terminus of C-lobe. And this particular fragment just hangs. It just hangs around because it has not been able to cut properly. So this particular hydrolysis was seeming to be a bit messy as comparison to the hydrolysis done by trypsin. But let me assure you that in nature, nothing is messy. Everything is in order. Nature plans everything perfectly. So this is just to show you how trypsin cuts. It's got an arginine over here, 341. No arginine or lysine over there. So it doesn't cut much. So we've got arginine 689, which is also the C terminus of the native lactoferrin. So it just makes one cut over here and no other cut anywhere else. So after we were able to figure out what trypsin and what protease K are doing, they're making almost an entire perfect C lobe and it is not able to cut it completely. But then the question that arose is, how does lactoferrin protect itself from proteases? Why don't the proteases cut lactoferrin to pieces? Because, you know, even if trypsin is not that non-specific, but still it cuts everywhere it sees arginine, lysine. So the question arises, and then of course we know about protease K, it just cuts non-specifically. There is no limit to where protease K can cut. So why don't the proteases cut lactoferrin to pieces? That was the question that was in front of us. So what we did was that we took the protease K after it had done the hydrolysis of lactoferrin. And we crystallized that protease K. And what we found was very interesting. We realized, this is the red is the surface diagram of the protease K. We realized that there is a fragment which is bound to this particular protease K. And this fragment comes from lactoferrin. So there is a fragment which is present inside lactoferrin, which is released upon hydrolysis. Once it cuts the N-lobe and C-lobe, and then there's a fragment which is released from lactoferrin which goes and binds to protease K so that it is not able to anymore cut lactoferrin. So this, you know, I was describing to you how innate immunity proteins have evolved along with the various bacteria and fungi. So this is an example of one of the most interesting evolutions, that there is a sequence which is designed by nature inside lactoferrin, which can go and bind to protease K, in a way binding it and not allowing it to cut anymore. So this is just the crystal structure of protease K, and this yellow one, as you can see, is a peptide of lactoferrin. Serine, aspartic acid, and histidine are the main residues of protease K to which this particular peptide has bound, so that the hydrolysis is not able to carry out because the triad is broken. So as I just now described to you, lactoferrin, this is lactoferrin, this is the N-lobe, this is C-lobe, and this red loop that you can see is a fragment that goes and binds to protease K, which, as you can see, it is completely exposed. Your protease K makes the first cut here. As it is coming to the next cut, this fragment comes out and does not allow it to cut lactoferrin anymore. So this is the way lactoferrin gets preserved to carry out its further function. So this is, once again, just to show, this yellow one is that particular peptide, N-lobe, C-lobe. So this ball which is revolving is protease K. It first comes and cuts at the interconnecting peptide. It's able to cut the interconnecting peptide, but when it wants to cut further, this peptide comes and binds to protease K, and it is no longer able to cut lactoferrin. And so NLO and CLO, even though they remained associated from each other, but they are able to carry out the function of lactoferrin because they are fully independent. Third, I will come to the third aspect. I was talking to you about the moonlighting wonder that is lactoferrin. There was a function which said that CLO produces NSAID. NSAID means non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. These are over-the-counter drugs that you have every other day, aspirin, diclofenac, every time you have pain, fever, even after a vaccination, whenever you get pain or fever, then you're told to simply have NSAIDs. That is how commonly prescribed these drugs are. You don't even need to take a prescription. You can just buy them and start having them. And what happens when you actually eat a lot of NSAIDs? Your stomach lining is destroyed and you get ulcerations. And sometimes these ulcerations can lead to even perforations in the stomach. And it has been seen that CLO of lactoferrin, it reduces NSAID-induced gastropathy. How? So we wanted to show a structural basis. So we worked on that. So this is just to tell you about the about this group of over-the-counter prescription medications, aspirin, ibuprofen, diclofenac, indomethacin, which we have very commonly. And they are the world's most heavily prescribed drugs, especially for elderly population, you know, the ones who are suffering from rheumatoid arthritis, osteoarthritis. All these people, they have NSAIDs almost every day, sometimes twice a day, thrice a day. So as a result, there are millions of prescriptions per year. So what happens is that how safe is it to ingest NSAIDs? It's not safe at all. If you have them have too many of them, you can have pain, bleeding, ulcer, obstruction, finally, perforation. And why do they do this? That is the most obvious question. That if you want to know that, you have to look at the structure of most of the NSAIDs. There's a planar aromatic ring with carboxyl group attached to it. And then there is a lipophilic group which is attached. So because of this particular structure, it is able to interact with the stomach lining. Why? Because the stomach epithelium, I've just made a PowerPoint presentation, this kind of a figure to show you how the stomach epithelium is. It has got the gastric mucosal barrier. This barrier is very important to protect your stomach against everything, you know, any harmful compound. This nature has actually designed this gastric mucosal barrier. And what is it made of? It is made of phospholipids. So, you know, this has got phosphate groups also and lipids also. And as I just described, your NSAIDs, this is just to show you that when the acid in your lumen, you know, stomach actually generates a lot of acid because that is how it digests all your food. This red drops are to show, just to show you how the acid is generated, but it is not able to affect your stomach because you've got this gastric mucosal barrier. And as I told you that phospholipids have got hydrophilic polar head group and hydrophobic tails, and your NSAIDs also have this hydrophobic group over here, and you have a carboxylic group. So they are able to bind to this particular phospholipid barrier. Once they are able to do that, your barrier breaks down, and that is how acid starts attacking your stomach lining, and then you get ulcers and perforations, and some, in extreme cases there are deaths also. So this is how a stomach lining looks like when it has got ulcers. So what we did was that we wanted to show how lactoferrin is able to actually reduce the NSAID-induced gastropathy. So we took four most commonly prescribed NSAIDs, aspirin, ibuprofen, indomethacin, and diclofenac. And we made we soaked the crystals of CLO, and we collected data, and we found that there is a common binding site of all NSAID which bind to CLO. This is the CLO, and these are the four NSAIDs. But if you see, they're all binding at the same site. So this was the entire structure of CLOB, and we found that this pink molecule is the NSAID, and there is this particular, this is iron, and this is the site that we mapped down. There is a beta J that is the longest beta strand, and there are two alpha helices, alpha 10 and alpha 11. So we've just rotated the molecule to show that this is the way the site is, alpha 10, alpha 11 and beta J. And there is a loop over here. This loop is between two beta strands, and this is the entire composite picture of the NSAID binding site. So this shows that lactoferrin is able to bind to NSAIDs. Once it's, you know, you must have seen that mostly people tell you that if you have milk along with these kind of drugs, then your gastric lining is protected. So this is the basis. Lactoferrin or C-lope is able to bind to these NSAIDs so that your NSAIDs are not, the excess NSAIDs are not able to go and actually attack your epithelium. This is further mapping of that site. So we wanted to see what exactly is in the site that it binds to NSAIDs so well. So we found that this beta J, it has got the hydrophobic residues which are projected outside in such a way that it acts like a magnet, so that the hydrophobic ring of the NSAID comes and straight away binds to this particular site. So this is the site. This is ibuprofen. As you can see, the hydrophobic ring is facing the beta J. Once again, diclofenac is also facing beta J. And finally, indomethacin, which is the largest NSAID. As you can see, the hydrophobic groups are all facing over here, and the carboxylic groups are facing towards alpha 10 and alpha 11, where they interact, as you can see over here. They interact with the, there is a lot of glutamic acid residues. So, which interact with the carboxylic groups in each of the cases. So now I have made this particular diagram to show that it is a B-shaped site. Now this is the beta J, which has got all the hydrophobic residues over here, valine, proline, alanine, etc. And this is the loop, which is again giving proline. And then these are the alpha 10, alpha 11. If you see, you know, there is glutamic acid, which these are the amino acids which actually interact with the acidic and the basic groups over there. So if we have to design a particular compound, because of which can reduce NSAID-induced gastropathy, then it has to look like this. And this is again the surface diagram of lactoferrin. This is the site which we have mapped over here. And this is the animation that shows you how the NSAID is coming and binding to the site. As you can see, it is orienting itself in such a way that its hydrophobic site is getting attracted towards this particular beta J. So NSAID binding site in C-lobe of lactoferrin identified. It is a wide amphipathic cavity. It is found on the surface. It has low specificity and low affinity, and it is able to bind to almost all the NSAIDs that we have seen. We have also done the animal studies in this particular case, and after doing the animal studies, we have realized that we designed animal studies in which we took some mice, and which I have not described over here. And we were able to again show that they are able to reduce the gastropathy, and they are able to reduce the inflammation in the guts of those particular mice. Now coming to my last slide, I'm searching for it as I think I have skipped it. This is the, okay, site identified, and the other conclusions. Lactoferrin is cut by both specific and non-specific enzymes. Non-specific protease produces both N-lobe and C-lobe with some peptides, but specific protease trypsin and also chymotrypsin, which I have not mentioned over here, it produces 45 kilodalton fragment, C-lobe, 21 LF and peptides. And as you can see, C-lobe is present in both the hydrolysates of all the proteases. trypsin does not cut at the C-terminus at all. Proteinase K cuts the C-terminus at three sites, resulting in a fragment hanging by a covalent bond. Now, we are still in our lab trying to search for the function of this particular fragment, which is hanging by a covalent bond, because as I said, that nature never makes a mistake. If nature is doing that, then there must be a purpose. And that is what we are trying to find out. And we have shown the evidence of structural evolution of C-terminus and the NSAID binding site identified on the surface of C-lobe. Finally, these are some of the structures that I just described, which are on the cover page of Acta Crystallographica D and Biophysical Journal. This was the one where we published our NSAID-induced gastropathy. And I acknowledge Gia, Dr. Pradeep Sharma, and my mentor. He's been my guide, and I think you guys must have heard him in the inaugural session, Professor T.P. Singh, the one who is the doyen of structural biology of India, and I'm proud to be a student, and so is Professor Sonika Bhatnagar. And finally, I want to talk in the end about my last three books, my books, Secret of Red Crystals. All the work that I have done on lactoferrin, I have written it in a very fictional autobiographical form in this book, Secret of Red Crystals. It begins with my journey as a student in 1991, and it ended in 2008 when I got the award by the President of India for this work on the structure of C-lobe. And I have also described some of the challenges faced by women scientists who have to, being in India, we have to actually prove ourselves. Also, there is a lot of responsibility, dual responsibility of the family as well as work in the lab. I have described that also in this book. And also the challenges which are faced by almost all students in who are working in science in India, I have described those as well. And Dragonfly's Purpose, which is again an autobiographical book of mine, in which I have described how I got an autoimmune disease, that is Guillain-Barré syndrome, in which one is paralyzed, and I was also paralyzed, and how I recovered from it so that I'm completely fit now. I thought it would be inspirational for people who are fighting with debilitating illnesses. And of course, Warriors in White is my recent book, which I wrote last year. And this is also autobiographical, and I've written about how the pandemic hit our country, hit the world and hit our country, and how we, all the people, were working at AIIMS, did not get a single leave. We have been coming every day without any leave and working hard on various aspects of COVID, whether it is hospital care or whether it is basic research. And I have also described about the journey of some very interesting COVID warriors who are literally the frontline workers right now. Even now, they've been working very hard. And this is my YouTube channel, Science Popularization by Professor Sujata Sharma. Do subscribe to it. Basically, I feel there's a lot of gap between the science and society, and I'm trying to bridge that gap, this particular gap, by talking about science in a very, 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 very simple terminology. Because, you know, we scientists tend to talk about science in our typical technical language, and the society finds it very hard to understand. So science remains limited within labs and conference halls and the Zoom talks that we are having right now, when actually it should go out there. And actually, there should be a scientific temperament in the society. As you know, especially in COVID times, it's become very obvious that society has no idea about what is even a virus or what is a vaccine. And I feel it is a duty of all medical researchers as well as all the scientists out there to actually get over the scientific elitism and start educating society. And so this is my channel. Do subscribe to it. Thank you very much for your attention. And I hope you all enjoyed my lecture. I definitely enjoyed talking to all of you. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am, definitely. It was a very informative and interesting lecture, especially the part of proteinase K, how, you know, hydrolysis is not taking place, and all those things were really very interesting. And I really want you to accept our congratulations, and the presentation was really very encouraging and interesting. So now we'll open the session for the queries. So we'll open for the questions. So we are getting
one question
many...
is already there in the chat box.
Yes, ma'am.
That is, that does this lactoferrin from complex form complex with NSAID or simply acts as a chelating agent? Is it,
it forms
a specific binding or not?
Yeah, yeah. There's a specific binding, as I have already shown in the slides. There is a particular site which is present in the C lobe because of which these NSAIDs are attracted, because of the hydrophobicity of the longest beta strand which is present in this particular C lobe. There is a long beta strand which has got all the exposed hydrophobic residues, so that the hydrophobic planar chain, planar ring of the NSAIDs is attracted towards it, and the carboxylic groups of the NSAIDs interact with the other charged residues which are present in two alpha, this thing. So that is how there is a specific site. It's not just chelating.
Then there's a question from Mr. Jagdish Chandra that can we use lactoferrin as an immunomodulative probiotic?
Yes, definitely. In fact, already it is being used. You know, this is already an FDA approved molecule. That is the best part. So any study that we do on it, whether we work on lactoferrin or whether we do C lobe, we are confident that we are able to actually take it to people. We are already, in fact, right now doing clinical trials in humans also, along with the Department of Microbiology in AIIMS. And abroad, actually, in Japan, people are using it as a probiotic. And because it has been shown to have an immunomodulation function.
I am to convey comments of K. Raju, Dr. Archana Kolera, and Ashok Behra. They say it's a very nice lecture and they have appreciated it.
There is another question from, I think, Ashok Behra is there. So, ma'am,
yeah, Ashok Behra.
So, like, have you done any immunogenicity studies for the this T terminal, the C terminal of the lactoferrin before using it as an NSAID? NSAID, that's what like the question is. No, I think he has not framed it well. There is some issue with the question.
We have not yet done any immunogenicity study. I think you mean that before using it as an NSAID binding protein, right?
Yeah, maybe.
So we have not done any immunogenicity study, but I'm expecting, of course, we should do it, but I'm expecting that since it's a completely natural protein, which is FDA approved, and it is also totally safe even in the newborn baby who have not been exposed to any kind of infection. So I do feel that this would be safe. But of course, we have worked on the animal model, and we are first going to do clinical trials on humans, then only we're going to take it forward.
Ma'am, there's another question which says, like, are there any are they binding same pocket or amino acids of COX-2? So which protein you use? I think it's mentions COX-2 for that.
Okay, COX-2 is also, I think, an NSAID binding
okay.
I think that is what they mean. Is that the question?
Yes, it looks like that. Yes, with respect to your same.
So no, I have not compared with the COX-2 so far, but interesting suggestion. I'm going to do that. Yeah, it's very interesting.
One more question is there. Could you illuminate the specific sites of lactoferrin with fungi? That is the question by Dr. Amin.
Could you please repeat the question?
The question is, could you illuminate the specific site of lactoferrin with fungi? Have you worked with funguses and all? This is...
Actually, proteinase K is a fungal protease only. It is isolated from, I think, T. alba, which is a fungi, and satellizin also, which is also the same class of proteins, is also a fungal protease. So we are basically working on fungal proteases only.
Yes, ma'am. So ma'am, how have you chosen lactoferrin for your studies? Like, how have you started with that lactoferrin?
I chose lactoferrin because it is known that lactoferrin is majorly found in the colostrum of mothers, you know, whether it is human, whether it is bovine, whether it is, and this is a protein which is totally safe, and it is extremely, it has got a great potency for microbes. So I did feel that this is the protein of choice, because when we are talking about smart bacteria, I feel this protein since millions of years has been evolving along with the bacteria and fungi, and it is able to actually already circumvent what is going to happen, and it quickly evolves. That is what is seen. And that is why, you know, everybody says that you must do the breastfeeding. You must do breastfeeding no matter what. That is because of lactoferrin and other proteins like lysozyme also, but lactoferrin is the major one that is doing it. So I felt that there would be a treasure, maybe a gold mine of, you know, antimicrobial therapeutics in this particular protein.
Yes, ma'am. So we'll be having another question also. How you compare the binding sites of clove with NSAIDs?
How did I bind?
Compare the binding sites of clove with NSAIDs?
So the binding site of clove, I think that's what you mean.
Yeah, it's written clove.
Written clove. Saath mein likha hoga. So the binding site of clove, you know, the basically the clove has got two iron binding, one iron binding site, which is on one side, and just behind the iron binding site is the NSAID binding site. That is what we found out. So the iron binding site of clove is not getting disturbed. In fact, the other side of clove is being used as the NSAID binding site. So this is how interesting nature is, that, you know, like we say, we wonder that why does nature make such a big molecule when the active site is so small, right? And, you know, it doesn't need to make such a big molecule, right? But actually it is making that big molecule because it is all those other other portions of that particular molecule are functioning for as some other functions. So that is what we were able to find out.
Another question.
Participant Ashok Dera, so he wants to ask you a question directly. So maybe I'll just unmute him and so that he can ask. Ashok Bera, you can directly ask the question.
Yes, madam. Very nice talk. Thank you very much. Bahut din baad ek acha sa talk ke liye mila. Really nice talk. Thank you very much, madam. So actually, I want to know that the proteins what you after the hydrolyzing, are they very big that can't be synthesized?
I'm sorry, can you please repeat loudly?
Yeah, I'm asking that what the after lactoferrin hydrolyzing, so can be it is degrading to the different parts of peptides, right? It can't be synthesized in the lab.
Yeah, we can synthesize any part of this protein in the lab, but actually we wanted to see what happens naturally. So what we did in case of hydrolysis or with, for example, pepsin, we actually replicated, we simply wanted to reproduce the same conditions as there are in the stomach. We use the same pH, which is in the stomach, that is 2.0, we using the same buffer, you know, so we wanted to see exactly what happens if we actually reproduce the same conditions. In case of trypsin, we used the pH, which is found in intestines, that is around 7.5 to 8.5. So we wanted to have a kind of a view what happens to lactoferrin when it goes down in your gut. But otherwise, yes, we have synthesized also, but to see the natural protein was more exciting.
That means you have also, after synthesizing, you have purified it, madam. So how, what would be the yield, madam, actually? Because we supposed to work the peptide, yield is very less. So you have worked on the protein again, hydrolyzing, then you must have purified it for the NSAID.
Yeah.
So it's really a hectic job. So I want to know the yield of that, how you have purified that, whether it is HPLC or some chromatogel chromatography.
I'll just tell you that what we did was we first isolated lactoferrin from the milk, and we used a combination of ion exchange and gel filtration chromatography. Then we did the hydrolysis using proteases, and then we again used ion exchange and gel filtration chromatography. So we have used mainly these two chromatographies.
Fine. So actually I want to know that you have shown a chart that four NSAIDs are there, and you have shown the pockets, right?
Right.
That what are the interacting, that data are the NSAID, you have sown with the FOX2 or with which protein you have sown that one? I want to know that actually.
Actually, I have not compared this binding site with the COX-2 binding site. But I am pretty much aware because we did some affinity studies and we found that it has got low affinity. COX-2, I think, binds with a very high affinity. Lactoferrin binds with low affinity, which is actually good news because, you know, if it binds with high affinity, then you will not have that much, you know, you're taking NSAIDs for pain or fever. Yes. But if lactoferrin is binding it with high affinity, you will not have that much NSAID left to do the job, which it's meant for. But if it binds with low affinity, then your major NSAID will actually do the job, which is to reduce the pain, inflammation, fever. But the excess of it will still be able to bind to lactoferrin, which will not harm your gut.
Okay. Okay, ma'am. So nice.
Sujatam, there is another question, like, is there any progress to treat Helicobacter pylori or the ulcer infection with using like lactoferrin?
Yeah, Helicobacter pylori is something which it's extremely dangerous. It does cause ulcers and yeah, that is also in the pipeline. Good suggestion. I haven't done it, yeah, but we're going to do it.
One more question, ma'am. Whether there is any comparison done between C1 and C2 lobe?
I think C1 and C, there is N lobe and then the C lobe. And each lobe, there are two domains, N1, N2 in N lobe, C1, C2 in C lobe. So we found that there's 40% homology between N lobe and C lobe. And in between C1 and C2, there's not much homology. And in case of N1 and N2, there's not that much homology.
One more question from Dr. Amin, that how N and C lobe work independently. The question is how
they work independently. As we have seen that N lobe, as I had said, you know what we did? We actually took, we were able to hydrolyze N lobe and C lobe in case of protein SK. So we took N lobe and put with protein SK and C lobe and put with protein SK. And we found C lobe is resistant to proteolysis. N lobe gets cut in very small peptides, and those small peptides which are produced by the hydrolysis of N lobe are the ones which go and bind to the lipopolysaccharides of bacteria. They bind to the bacterial membrane, so they are mainly work as antibacterial. So N lobe actually sacrifices itself into small peptides, but C lobe remains whole. It does not get cut into small peptides. As a whole, it functions. And it does all those functions. As we have seen one case, that entire site remains and it is able to bind the NSAIDs. And maybe other functions are also done with the entire C lobe, but N lobe gets cut.
So the next question is, but I think you have already answered, what do you think, why the nature preferred to have both N and C lobe together?
I just said, because both have different functions.
So another question, did you study the anti-cancer activity of this lactoferrin?
No, I have not studied the anti-cancer activities so far, but a lot of groups have studied and it has got a potent anti-cancer activity. And now very soon, we are actually making, lactoferrin nanoparticles also. They have found that they are actually being used as vehicles to transport drugs. That is because lactoferrin nanoparticles are able to cross the blood-brain barrier. And in case of gliomas, which are very difficult, you know, brain cancer, why people who have brain cancers are not able to survive is because so many drugs are not able to cross the blood-brain barrier. So they have maximum 15 months to live. And lactoferrin is the one which is used. Lactoferrin nanoparticles now recently are they being used to carry the anti-cancer drugs to these particular gliomas. Apart from that, also lactoferrin itself per se is being used as an anti-cancer agent in various cancer cell lines.
So the next question is, does interlinked loop give flexibility to lactoferrin?
I think interlinked loop does not give much flexibility. It is there only to connect both the C lobe and N lobe together. Main flexibility is seen in the N1, N2 domain and C1, C2 domain where iron binding takes place. As I had shown, It opens up and closes. That's a hinge mechanism, and that is where flexibility is.
Okay. Ma'am, another question. Have you identified the sequences of protein after hydrolysis of NLO? Have you identified the sequences of peptide after hydrolysis of NLO?
Yes, we have. And we found many of them are amphipathic, which amphipathic means that they have hydrophobic as well as hydrophilic. And they are mostly tryptophan and arginine rich, which is why they are such successful candidates in actually going and binding to these particular bacterial membranes.
So the another question that lactoferrin binds to neutrophils, so it seems it has negative impact on role.
No, it doesn't bind to neutrophils. I think, I said it's found in neutrophils. It's actually present inside the neutrophils, and it has got a big role in immunomodulation.
There is a question regarding the participant who asked you personally, Ashok. He wants to know whether you can share the sequences of these peptides which you have obtained after cleavage.
Maybe if he can send me a mail.
Okay.
My mail is sujatasharma.aiims@gmail.com. Then I will share you, because right now in my slides I don't have them.
Okay, ma'am, I will convey it.
Okay.
I'm sure he must have heard it. So I think if that is all, I think we are we should thank Professor Sujata Sharma for an excellent talk, and it was extremely interesting, and you kept the audience. There was not even a single moment where we felt we are losing you out, and though there were some technical difficulties, but you made up with your talk, ma'am, literally.
Thank you so much, ma'am,
and I'm sure the participants, the female participants, they must have got a lot of inspiration and motivation to pursue science as a career. And again, you have shown another side of yours, it's just not scientists who just do lab work, there are other things to life which one can pursue along with that. So I think you are a role model for us, ma'am. Thank you so much. So I would like to conclude the session, and once again thank Professor Sujata Sharma for an excellent talk. And we'll meet at 3:30 for the next session. Thank you all for joining.
Everyone, when I asked her to give a talk, she said that I don't do teaching kind of talks. So I said that we don't want a teaching kind of talk. We want somebody to give a very interesting talk. And I think that was the right way to go.
Yes.
Thank you, Suja.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
We really had a good start to our FDP, man.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's true, sir.
Actually, I'll be honest. I usually avoid conferences because I feel that sometimes they get very boring, and because you have to listen to technical details of other people, and you don't sometimes understand them also. So I just was hoping that I made it extremely simple, and going by your comments, I do feel I succeeded. Thank you very much. It's been a great honor, a great pleasure. Thank you. And especially to the audience, all the people who asked me questions, thanks a lot. It has made the talk so lively. Thanks.
Thank you, everyone, and we'll see you at 3:30 for the next session.
Thank you.
Thank you.